20 years ago, when the Deccan Development Society was born, it was conceived purely as a grassroots organization. Its mission was poverty alleviation, just the way most NGOs at that time thought civil society should be working. The society has traversed a long road since then.
The very first action plan of this NBSAP process is a people's plan.
In the year 2005, after 20 years, DDS is seen as an organization that has been able to link local and global policy processes. This film would like to profile some of the high points of the process. The Deccan Development Society works in 70 villages. Each village has a sangham, a village-level women's group. The women primarily come from the Dalit castes, socially and economically the most marginalized groups in India. This marginalization has not put them down. On the contrary, they have demonstrated an extraordinary capacity to regenerate their soils, their agriculture, their environment, and their communities. Today they are one of those rare rural groups in India who have been designing their own autonomy. In the process, the women have become the most powerful articulators of their concerns and choices. Over the years, they have seamlessly progressed from doing their own advocacy from a local level to national and international levels. In the cycle of autonomies that the women created, The most striking has been the community food sovereignty system designed and operated in over 50 of their communities. The government PDS was aimed at creating food security for the poor, but in the process, it had centralized the entire operation, marginalizing local crops and local communities. This was based on the belief that only preferred grains grown in richly endowed areas of the country can supply food to food-deficient areas. This overlooks the fact that agriculture in every so-called food-deficient area can be regenerated and enabled to produce food for itself. The Deccan area, which grows a range of millets under rain-fed conditions, is a case in point. The PDS had subverted this agriculture. The DDS communities waged a battle against this unfair system that was enervating their farming environment. As they succeeded in establishing the parallel system in their communities, they decided to fight for a change in the public policy.
పాల బియ్యాన్ని కొనుగోలు మన దిక్కు చేపిస్తున్నాడు. అయితే మన కొర్ర బియ్యము మనద వన్య బియ్యమును అదే రేషన్ కార్డులకు ఆ బియ్యం ఇచ్చే బదులు మన కొర్ర బియ్యంని ఇస్తే మనకు అప్పుడు మార్కెట్ అనేది పెరుగుతుంది, మనకు ధర వస్తుంది, మన నూనెకు ధర వస్తుంది, అప్పుడు మనము ఇంకా.
This was done at various levels, the local, the regional, and the All India level. NIRD, the National Institute for Rural Development, the Apex Rural Development Policy Academy of the Government of India, echoed the same sentiments. In a recommendation done on the national consultation, the NIRD recommendations were loud and clear.
In dry land areas, procurement, storage and distribution should be taken up on coarse cereals. For improving food security at village level, especially in drought-prone areas, cultivable fallow should be used optimally to produce food grains, including local millets, needed by the village community. In addition, traditional food storage system based on locational food cultural appropriateness should be devised for participatory technology development.
In a national consultation on food security in 2005, there was a consensus that this was the only way forward for food security. This was endorsed by two topmost policy makers of the state of Andhra Pradesh, which is the fifth largest state in India and hence occupies a prime position in policy circles.
Most of you have been advising or rather propagating the local production, the production of the millets and also the consumption. So from government side, including the government of India, there will not be any reservation in giving any type of food grain which is required for the grain bank. Whichever food grain is preferred by the people, they will definitely supply. There's no problem at all in supplying of those food grains.
What is missing in our intervention is the local production part of it. That is, we have not really concentrated on that. So as part of village food security and nutrition security plan, the using the fallow lands or the dry lands for local cereal production is a very important element, and that is where I think we can integrate the local production, local processing, local distribution.
The best moment for the DDS women came when the father of Indian PDS, Mr. Venugopal, visited them. He saw what they had achieved, discussed with them, and wrote in the visitor's book.
As one associated with the development of the PDS in Andhra Pradesh and India, I record here on the basis of my study of the project that this indeed is the PDS we need in our country. a PDS that assures agricultural, food and seed security in the context of the urgent need for a decentralized, autonomous green revolution and public distribution system.
Apart from the PDS, the women farmers of DDS made many more contributions to the massive National Biodiversity Strategy and Action Plan, NBSAP. Agro-biodiversity is very close to the heart of the DDS farmers. Farmers such as Rayapalle Sushilamma grow up to 22 crops on their 1 acre farm. Farmers like Anjama save up to 80 seed varieties in their community seed bank. It is this amazing diversity on their farms and in their seed banks that the DDS farmers celebrate in their annual Mobile Biodiversity Festival. The five-year-old festivals were the tool the DDS women used to prepare an agro-biodiversity plan for the Deccan. This was a totally participatory process and was entirely led by women farmers.
వాళ్ళ పంట చేసి ఎరువేసి బయముగులు బండ్లకమానం మలజొన్నలు తొగాళ్ళు మర ఆర్కలు మర కొర్రలు కొర్ర పంటలు ఇప్పుడు పెడుతున్నారా కొర్ర పంటలు పెడుతున్నారు.
This is the first of the NBSAP plan.
The outcome was the first plan on agro-biodiversity in the NBSAP. This was a sunshine moment for the communities of DDS. At the back of all these efforts lies the looming threat of genetic engineering in agriculture, which is globally threatening farm ecology, smallholder agriculture, and biodiversity. Every year when the research was made public, it created a huge stir in the media and policy circles by unveiling new dimensions of the destruction wrought by BT cotton.
BT cotton did not significantly reduce pesticide use.
Far more remarkable were the films made on the BT cotton cultivation by a group of women farmer filmmakers. Each year they made devastating films that authentically articulated the pain, anger and sufferings of small farmers who had planted BT cotton. Their films, called Why Are Warangal Farmers Angry with BT Cotton and BT Cotton in AP, a 3-year fraud, were translated into English, French, Spanish, Thai, Swahili, and created a wave of anger across the globe on the hype and fraud of the biotech industry.
Pamba limekuwa uti wa mgogo katika biashara ya kilimo kusini mwa taifa la India, sehemu ya Andhra Pradesh.
The research, when completed in 2005, created history by forcing the government of India to ban the BT cotton varieties marketed by Monsanto in Andhra Pradesh. The campaign, the research and the films facilitated by DDS also resulted in a complete ban on Monsanto by the government of AP. This was a moment of great triumph for the Sangams of the DDS. They had achieved goals that they had cherished for so long.
Organic farmers, these are the organic farmers.
Intricately related to the issue of food sovereignty was the issue of organic farming. Therefore, when Organic Farming Association of India, the first such association in the country, was formed in the year 2002, DDS was happy to accept the invitation and become a member of the National Steering Committee. DDS has played a key role in OFAI, advancing several arguments that are normally sidelined in organic farming movements. The DDS arguments include the primacy of small and marginal farmers in organic agriculture, the special place for women, Dalits and indigenous people in the movement, the danger of a stranglehold on organic produce by supermarket chains, the trap of certification that will enervate small-scale ecological producers and therefore the need for community certification. The DDS has continuously stressed that the organic movement must be led by farmers and not other interests in an agrarian nation such as India. In the Asian region, DDS is a member of the Biodiversity Action for Sustainable Agriculture Asia, or BASA Asia, an Asian network. It is on the steering group of BASA Asia and works as its key partner in India. It is the primacy of farmers that has always informed various networks of which DDS is a part. The SANFEC network is distinguished by the numerous farmer exchanges within the region and internationally. DDS farmers have received farmers from Nepal, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, many times in their biodiversity festivals and in other events. They have also visited all the South Asian countries. The exchanges have not only strengthened the basic precepts of SANFEC, food, ecology and culture, and their symbiotic relationship, but also build people-to-people relationships and help create an environment of peace and friendship among farming communities.
Towards reshaping,
South Asian
agricultural policies.
SANFEC has also facilitated such farmer exchanges outside of South Asian countries, primarily between Canada and India. The DDS farmers traveled to Canada to visit the farms and fields of Canadian organic farmers in the year 2002 and developed a close relationship with them. The Canadian farmers reciprocated this visit and came to India and participated in DDS biodiversity festivals.
As a part of the Sustaining Local Food Systems, Agricultural Biodiversity and Livelihoods Network, DDS farmers played host to farmers from Iran and Peru in 2005. The pastoralists from Iran narrated their culture, the contribution that pastoralists made to enhance local biodiversity, environment and livelihoods, even while struggling against the government policies that constantly oppress them. Quechua pheasants from Peru explained the significance of their potato diversity, the role it plays in their culture, food systems and livelihoods. There was also a story of successful struggle against international ag research institutions and the agreement they have entered into with Central Institute for Potato. The DDS Sangam women in turn shared their experiences of food and seed sovereignty, the control they have gained over their food systems, their culture and its intrinsic relationship with biodiversity.
In the year 2003, about 8 farmers from DDS went to Peru and spent a week visiting the potato park and savoring the diversity on the Quechua farms. Their visit to the barter markets on the Laris Mountains left them speechless. This was an ideal they would carry in their minds always. These were great learnings for them. In turn, the farmers from DDS taught the technique and ethos of community biodiversity registers to the Peruvian farmers. They also presented their experiences with community media production and screened their films for the Quechua people. Together, the Dalits from DDS and the Quechuas from Andes discussed and debated the issues of community knowledge and the ways to protect them with top-level policy makers of Peru. Another major farmer exchange in which DDS farmers played a key role was in Cambodia in 2004. The Basa Asia facilitated exchange was to discuss the status and need for farmer-led research. Even more contemporary was the theme of Bangkok consultation on confronting contamination. On what is normally seen as a complex issue of genetic engineering in agriculture, the farmers of DDS made powerful and cogent contributions. Thus, the cycle of farmer exchanges in DDS continues to traverse many territories, some familiar such as biodiversity, and some contemporary and modern such as genetic engineering. In this heady politics, farmer exchanges and alliances on focused issues, the DDS never forgot that it had to address larger questions of policy context. The global actors who were promoting neoliberal policies, of which genetic engineering was just one component. One of the first manifestations of this was the village-level rallies against Vision 2020, the policy manifesto of the neoliberal government of Andhra Pradesh. For months on end, the women of DDS protest marched the streets of hundreds of villages in Andhra Pradesh. They held village-level meetings and passed resolutions against the Vision 2020. The rallies converged into a state-level civil society meeting which came out with a Hyderabad declaration against Vision 2020. The village-level rallies, state-level meetings, morphed into an unprecedented event in Pastapur village in the year 2002. Called Praja Tirpu, the farmers' jury on food and farming futures of Andhra Pradesh was a major milestone in the history of civil society in India. It was an exercise in deliberative democracy involving marginal livelihood citizens.
విజన్ 2020 ప్రకటించినప్పుడు కోళ్ల పరిశ్రమను ఒక ప్రధానమైన అభివృద్ధి సాధనంగా గుర్తించారు.
It was a unique way of presenting multiple scenarios about their future and facilitate their selection of one or a combination of them or a completely new scenario.
బిడ్డలు పాపలు తగడ పూసుండవు ఎక్కడ భూములు అక్కడ తాకి మేము ఆ విధానం బతికేది
మరి ఒడ్ల గింజకు జన్ని మార్పుల నుంచి.
It was a way of putting farmer first and the privileged last. As opposed to public hearings where farmers download their woes, this was a place where farmers heard the decision makers defending their decisions.
So, this is the golden rice, which is slightly yellow in color. It has got vitamin A in it by genetic engineering.
Finally, this was a forum where farmers gave the verdict and not the privileged. The wider significance of Prajatirpu were many. It was a discourse on modernization, coercion and exclusion. It was a debate on making development aid work for the poor. It was a vision of more civilization and less market. The Prajatirpu thus was the reflection of all the dreams and ideologies of the DDS women sanghams, which had constantly demanded the highest space and recognition for farmers' articulation and vision. In the development world, the Prajatirpu was an electrifying event. This was picked up by development practitioners across the globe as the ideal way to make democracy and governance work. When the report was released in the House of Commons annex in the UK by one of the members of the jury, it flashed across the globe and made huge headlines in the UK. A political uproar about the role played by UK's Department for International Development, DFID, in sustaining the neoliberal, anti-farmer character of Andhra Pradesh's Vision 2020 followed Prajatirpu. The UK Parliament had to institute an inquiry into the role of DFID in foreign funding. Prajatirpu thus became a watermark for the matrix of development led by women farmers from the margins of society. From the village streets to the global highways, the women of DDS Sanghams had traveled a very long way. And during this travel, they had never forgotten to spread the message of their autonomy and the primacy of their knowledge. In this process, they had amplified their voice so brilliantly that they were reaching the mega policy years. What they were saying and doing were being heard and seen by millions of ears and eyes across the globe. It was the triumph of the small and the determined.